Welcome into another episode of Shot Callers. I'm joined by Scott Atherton, president of IMSA. Now, Scott, it's been a heck of a few years for you guys, right? You guys are on the upswing, but I think it all started with the merger between the Grand Am and the Le Mans series. Can you talk about that?
Well, it goes back, just to give you a brief history, for 13 years, there was two competing sports car championships in North America. For the better part of 13 years, both survived, but candidly, neither one thrived. So in September of 2012, a merger took place, which was really an acquisition, but it was treated as a merger in that a best practices approach was put into play. We then came together as one beginning in January of 2014, first event being the Rolex 24 at Daytona. That is what put us on the track that we're on now, no pun intended. But it's been a wild ride, and candidly, it's never been better.
Yeah, 4 years later, right, you're seeing record high TV numbers, just signed a 6-year deal with NBC. You know, where does IMSA go from here?
We've got a lot of change still that's occurring, and all for the good. We held our State of the Series update last night. We have a new television relationship that you just described, great opportunity with NBC, an 80% increase in network television coverage. All of our events flag to flag on NBCSN when they're not on the network. Full live coverage flag to flag through the NBC Sports app, through NBC.com. So it is a massive improvement for us in terms of connectivity and availability and predictability. When you've got an event that lasts 24 hours, it's not possible to have a single network that's going to cover that type of a duration. But with NBCSN, at least we'll have the majority of it, and people will know where to find us. We have a new official tire partner with Michelin. We've had a great relationship with Continental for many, many years, but Michelin will now treat this as the core of their North American marketing platform. The level of activation that's going to come from that, unprecedented.
So you'd say IMSA is probably as healthy as it's ever been?
No question.
And because of that, you now have new commercial opportunities, right? And activating and bringing into these brands, right? You can go out to the market and now sell 80% more of the TV for your brands. What does that look like when you're approaching these and how you've been able to work with some of these the brands that you have relationships with?
We have a base of manufacturer involvement, which is unmatched. When you think about some of the other major motorsports categories, if they have one, two, or three manufacturers involved, that's considered high watermark. Between all of the IMSA properties under the IMSA umbrella, we actually have 18 manufacturers actively competing. And in our example, it just doesn't mean that they happen to have a car competing in the race. There's a full marketing commitment that has to go hand in hand with their entry on the grid. So they're actively involved with our TV broadcasts, they're actively involved with our event promoter partners, they're bringing displays, they're sponsoring events, they're activating their involvement with us away from the racetrack. It's all by contractual agreement. You couple that with some of the other premium branded corporate partnerships we have. Our title partner in our premier category is WeatherTech, very high profile, some would say the most prolific advertiser that we could ever have aligned with, and I wouldn't argue with that. And of course, they're using this platform as one of their primary activation points.
And you mentioned obviously the digital, the physical, but a lot of it that comes you tying in is the relatability aspect of people going and being able to say, hey, that Corvette I saw on the street is the Corvette that's over there. Is that an opportunity and an advantage for you in terms of other motorsport series?
It's the secret sauce, it really is. And you use the Corvette as the example. I would invite you to go through the Corvette Corral here. I'm gonna guess there'll be 300 plus Corvettes. And these are brand disciples. These people bleed Corvette. And when their cars don't do well on the track, our inboxes get blown up. They're passionate.
It's your fault, right?
Absolutely, yeah, of course. If the cars didn't win, there must be some fault involved. But you can't possibly buy that kind of brand loyalty and connectivity. They use it not only as just an opportunity to celebrate the brand, but they do focus groups. They bring in the engineers. They talk to the consumers in this motorsport environment to say, what do you want on the next generation Corvette? What's important to you? And it's not lip service. They take that information back. I mean, this is from the front lines of the people that are putting down hard-earned dollars to acquire that vehicle and then become that brand disciple. It's a comprehensive, vertically integrated activation that starts at the dealers. It starts at their known owners, their acquiring names, addresses, email addresses, understanding when the next purchase opportunity may be, 6 months from now, 12 months from now, whenever. It creates a link there that they won't let them get away easily, that's for sure.